welcome. Alan Moore's take on H.P. Lovecraft's mythos is somewhat problematic. All three related miniseries were published by Avatar Press, a publisher known for allowing their creators unrestricted creative freedom. Generally speaking, this results in a fair amount of sex and violence, illustrated in a rather graphic manner. These Alan Moore miniseries are no exception. With that in mind, let's tread carefully into a lesser-known piece of work by this well-regarded writer. The Courtyard is a two-issue adaptation of an Alan Moore short story from 1995. This story originally appeared in the anthology The Starry Wisdom, a tribute to H.P. Lovecraft. In fact, the original prose story was later reprinted by Avatar Press. The Courtyard follows renegade FBI agent Aldo Sachs as he investigates a series of seemingly unrelated murders. This leads to a nightclub located in Red Hook, a dealer named Johnny Carcosa, and the discovery of something known as Aklo. In the end, Sachs commits a murder similar to the ones he's been investigating. This story contains a lot of obscure and well-known Lovecraftian references and elements. For example, the setting, Red Hook, the band, the Ulther Cats, and the song, The Zan Variations, are all based on titles of Lovecraft's stories. Aklo is a fictional primal language which, for the purposes of this trilogy, modifies a person's perception of reality. This was something Lovecraft himself integrated from a story written by Arthur Machen titled The White People. Johnny Carcosa is named after the Ambrose Bierce story, An Inhabitant of Carcosa. That name is probably more well known from the first series of True Detective, which borrowed this fictional location from the work of Robert Chambers. Of course, Chambers, who used it liberally in The King in Yellow, borrowed the name from Bierce. Keeping with that tradition, Moore does recycle and modernize these occult elements. Also, with the character of Sachs, Moore incorporates the moderately racist and sexually repressed overtones implied in Lovecraft's work. As an adaptation, one that didn't have Moore's involvement whatsoever, it is rather well done. So as a story that's adjacent to the established mythology, it's a solid read. Neonomicon is one of the most unusual additions to Moore's bibliography. This four-issue series is extremely straightforward and lacks any subtlety. In a few words, it's brutal, explicit, and leaves a distinctly bad taste in one's brain after reading it. In interviews, Moore does admit he was in a terrible mood when he wrote Neonomicon due to the difficulties he experienced around his interactions with DC concerning the Watchmen movie. And it was written in order to offset the financial burden of an incoming tax bill. So the inspiration for this miniseries begins in a rather bad place. Two FBI agents, Merrill Breers and Gordon Lamper, investigate a series of murders that are very similar to the ones committed by the former agent, Aldo Sachs. They retrace Sachs's footprints and attempt to locate and apprehend Johnny Carcosa. While unsuccessful, they do discover a lead that takes them to an occult store in Salem, Massachusetts. Going undercover, they investigate the store and, after ingratiating themselves with the owner, they're invited to an orgy that evening. Things turn very dark very soon thereafter. Lamper is killed outright, and Breers is used as a very unwilling sex toy for a monstrous amphibian creature. Eventually, the creature releases Breers, believing her to be pregnant with its child. It ends with the occult group and the creature being slaughtered. Breers then visits Aldo Sachs to inform him that she is indeed pregnant with a very special child. As Alan Moore accurately points out, H.P. Lovecraft was notoriously adverse to mentioning any carnal activities in his work. However, that's not unusual for speculative fiction of that era. More to the point, there is a noticeable lack of women in Lovecraft's fiction. Again, not entirely unusual for the era and the genre, but perhaps the lack of women is a bit more noticeable in Lovecraft's work than other contemporary examples. One does get the sense that Lovecraft was uncomfortable and unfamiliar with female sexuality, so he just avoided addressing it, even in the most oblique manner. And Moore thought he'd add this missing sex element into the mythos. However, one can easily argue that rape isn't sex. While its inclusion in the story is thematically consistent, it still feels problematic. Possibly this is due to its graphic nature and the fact that it occurs repeatedly over a period of time. Furthermore, the character who endures this violent series of acts is a recovering sex addict. This is a character detail that is odd. It seems included to either lessen or heighten the impact of the brutality the character faces. In other words, its inclusion and intent is confusing. Overall, this 4-issue miniseries is a very uncomfortable read. Depending on one's taste, it's likely not going to be an enjoyable reading experience. Providence is somewhat challenging in the sense that it is rather dry and somewhat boring. The core concept, exploring the landscape that possibly influenced Lovecraft, is conceptually sound. However, it reads like slightly fictionalized research. While it may be an accurate representation of early 20th century locations, that doesn't necessarily make it interesting reading. The story focuses on Robert Black, a journalist who decides to travel around New England to discover the weird, occult outsiders living on the fringe of society. Essentially, this is an extended trip through a variety of New England locations. It also includes an equally diverse amount of people, all of whom have parallels to Lovecraft's fiction. There are far too many analogues to mention in a reasonable amount of time. Unfortunately, there is yet another rape scene, this one with a twist. The protagonist is both the perpetrator of the crime and the victim of it, and it's done with the body of a 13-year-old girl. So there's that too. Eventually, the protagonist meets with H.P. Lovecraft, and he seemingly encourages the writer to explore what would become known as the Cthulhu mythos. There is a very intricate and obscure series of connections that all revolve around this author, suggesting, quite possibly, that there was a silent occult conspiracy that involved Lovecraft as the centerpiece. The entire series is very similar to one portion of From Hell. In one chapter, the protagonist, William Gull, goes from location to location in London, examining specific pieces of architecture and their significance. It concludes with a pentagram one can draw over a map of London. It's an intriguing trip that disguises its true intent. Regardless, the point being, it was well researched and somewhat interesting in its presentation. Expanding that one chapter over 11 issues produces a result that is less than interesting. It comes off as a very dry history lesson. Certainly, there is character progression and a narrative thread to hold the series together, but it feels less like a story and more of a lecture. The issue that concludes this series takes place in the present time. Meryl Breers, the character from Neonomicon, is now full term, and she gives birth to a baby Cthulhu. The world transforms, fiction becomes real, and a new age is upon the universe. In a manner of speaking, Providence is somewhat similar to the final issues of Promethea. That is, by thoroughly addressing the premise and by recontextualizing Lovecraft's fiction, these stories become a transformative work, both symbolically and literally. In essence, Providence becomes a historical documentary. Lovecraft's work, and by extension, Moore's interpretation thereof, transforms a body of fiction into reality. That being said, Providence has the tone of a conspiracy theory. A group of disparate elements, all of which have vague, probably meaningless connections, are grouped together, given a new context, and presented as a discovery of some important truth. The level of truth discovered is dependent on the level of acceptance one has of the initial premise. However, that is not the major issue with this series of stories. The problem with this trilogy is it devalues the major theme Lovecraft explored in his fiction. And that theme was the irrelevancy of human life to the cosmic beings in the universe. The beings within the pantheon of terrible monster gods do not even recognize our presence. That is the point of Lovecraft's tales. It is the ultimate nihilistic perspective concerning humanity, our achievements, and our potential. Regardless of how advanced we consider ourselves, those accomplishments are absolutely meaningless to beings that have lived for millennia and probably exist in dimensions that merely intersect with the ones we're locked into. We aren't even a means to an end to these beings. We are, at best, microscopic lint in the omnipresent void of eternity. That is the horror found in Lovecraft's writings. However, by the end of Providence, humanity has an important role in the Cthulhu mythos, and the tales of Lovecraft become prophecies. Humanity ushers in a new era of gods, ones that will unlock reality, so to speak. Thus, humans become an important component to the mythos. Without humans, Cthulhu wouldn't be born. Presumably, without Cthulhu, the other terrible nameless beings wouldn't emerge, and reality wouldn't transform into its full potential. In this context, these stories validate the self-involved, self-important point of view human beings have of themselves and their necessity to the universe. We are a pathway to divinity, which undermines the main tenet of the stories Lovecraft wrote. Moore did justify this creative choice by pointing out that Cthulhu has a human form, unlike the rest of the monster gods, who are more abstract in nature. Due to this, it's not a leap of logic to suggest that Cthulhu has a specific human origin. But that presumes a bipedal form with two upper and lower extremities is a unique attribute to human beings. In an infinite universe, where life may flourish outside our capability to locate it, the form we have evolved into may be common. We simply don't know. Therefore, we can't presume we are unique. To presume otherwise is, as mentioned earlier, a self-involved point of view with a bias towards humanity being important to the cosmos. In the end, it's difficult to recommend these Lovecraft-inspired stories. Not only is some of the content intentionally objectionable, but, depending on one's familiarity and interpretation of the mythos, the conclusions made are in conflict with the actual material Lovecraft wrote. On a more positive note, Providence is a cogent, mature, and thorough examination of both H.P. Lovecraft and the mythology he explored through his fiction. It challenges the consensus and presents a unique, if not overly magical, perspective concerning the author, his work, and the influence of both on those that interpret the world through fiction. That's it for today. Like, share, subscribe, and comment, and I will talk at you later. Until next time.